Hi, Shalom. Thanks for joining. My name is Rav Ari Silberman. I'm the educational director at the Amiel Institute, which deals with preparing shlichim and rabbanim to go to the diaspora and work with communities. A few days ago, just in the lead up to Shavuot, the world experienced the sale of the Sassoon Codex, the oldest Bible in the world, the oldest Tanakh, complete Tanakh in the world, that was sold for over $38 million. Sold to the friends of the Anu Museum, the Diaspora Museum in Tel Aviv. It was bought as a testament to the Jewish people. Imagine that. The Jewish Torah, the Jewish Tanakh, sold for millions of dollars, meaning other people wanted to spend that kind of money on it as well. It serves as a testament to the impact that the Tanakh has had on the entire world. It is not just something for us, it is also something for the entire world. However, I want to ask what this has to do with Shavuot, and also what this has to do with Shavuot in the context of Sfirat HaOmer. What is it about the Torah that we celebrate on Shavuot, which is so, so important, but at the same time reflects a kind of blurriness and fuzziness about the Torah? What do I mean? When we received the Torah, it was one of the greatest moments in all of history. Not only for our people, but for the entire world. Hashem literally spoke to us. We're told by the Torah that Hashem came down to the mountain. He spoke to us from Shamayim. It's a day that, according to Nehemiah, declares that Hashem comes down to the mountain to speak from heaven. And in the words of Rabbi Akiva in the Mechilta, Hashem literally bent the heavens to the mountaintop. It was a day when heaven and earth merged. There are various other descriptions in Tehillim Yudchet particularly, about Hashem's booming voice, hail, fire, shaking of the earth. It was such a momentous occasion. Further, we're told by the Mechilta that the mountain itself was lifted up. And according to some opinions, the people themselves went up to Shamayim to receive the Torah. What a momentous, momentous occasion. And how could it be otherwise? We're told in the first Midrash in Bereshit Rabbah that when Hashem created the world, He looked into the Torah and created the world. Think about that, what that means for a second. The Torah was created before the world, and the world was created using the Torah as a blueprint. Says the Midrash, just like a craftsman goes and builds a house, Hashem used the Torah as a blueprint. What does that mean? According to Rav Yitzchak Kuttner, what this means is that Hashem created the world on the basis of the laws of Torah. Why is it that when I steal, it's bad for society? Because, says Rav Kuttner, Hashem looked at the Torah, and in the Torah it said, don't steal, and then when He created the world, He created a way that stealing was bad for society. What this means is that when Hashem gave us the Torah, Am Yisrael were realizing the very basic fibers of the world. We weren't only coming together with Hashem, but it was a merging of Hashem, Am Yisrael, and the Torah itself. Therefore, when we read the Psukim about how amazing this event was at Sinai, it is no wonder that we're blown away by what the spectacle must have been, something which is unfathomable. And yet, with everything I've said about the importance of Matan Torah, the festival of Shavuot, in which we celebrate Matan Torah, is shrouded in mystery. Chazal tell us that it's Man Matan Torah Teinu. But if you look in the Psukim, you can see that there is not a reference to Matan Torah in the Torah itself. We're told in Shmot that it's called Chag Katzir Bikurei Maasecha. In Shmot Lamed Dalet, we're told Bikurei Katzir Chitim. In Vayikra Kaf Gimel, Usfaltem Lachem, and you should offer Minchat to Hashem. In Bamidbar, it's called Uvayom HaBikurim. In Dvarim Tetvav, Maachel Chermesh Bekamah. Meaning, Shavuot, unlike the other two regalim, is only a festival of agriculture, at least as it's described in the Psukim. Whereas Pesach has a historical component, obviously it connects us leaving Mitzrayim and an agricultural component. And Sukkot also has a historical component about us leaving Mitzrayim and dwelling in Sukkot and an agricultural component. Shavuot, it seems, according to the Pshat of the Psukim, is not tied to Matan Torah. Similarly, in the Torah itself, when it describes Matan Torah, it doesn't give a date. It says in Shmot Yudchet that when Bnei Israel come to Midbar Sinai, it is in the third month, on that day. It doesn't give a date for Matan Torah. Mechilta as well seems to suggest that the rabbis were in dispute as to the exact date of Shavuot. Was it on the 6th or was it on the 7th? Meaning, there seems to be a certain fuzziness surrounding Matan Torah, surrounding the date of Shavuot. The connection between Shavuot and Matan Torah is not made explicit. How can this be that such a momentous celebration is not really all that clear? Why isn't it written? Why isn't it tied in the Torah? And I would add another level to that and say that when we today, or according to the Torah, set the date for Shavuot, it's dependent on how we count. When we count Mimacharat HaShabbat, and as an extension of this, in the Second Temple period and later on, when people debated whether the Torah Shebaal Peh was true or not, there were people that counted at a different cycle. So therefore you see, there is something very, very strange about Matan Torah. Its date is not given really in the Torah. It isn't tied to a festival like Shavuot. Shavuot itself isn't tied to Zman Matan Torah like it is in Chazal. And the actual date is a little bit fuzzy. Rashi offers us a interesting insight into perhaps why this is. On the Pasuk in Shmot Yudchet, when it says that we came to Midbar Sinai on this day, Etzem Hayom Hazeh, Rashi says, why doesn't give the day? Why does it say this day? It's because the Torah should be new to you as though it was given today. Now, of course, Chazal don't just invent this idea, chas v'shalom, that Shavuot is Matan Torateinu. Anyone who can do the maths and works back from Yom Kippur knows that the Torah was given around the time of Shavuot. More than this, the korbanot offered during Shavuot are akin to the korbanot offered during Matan Torah. So it's clear that Matan Torah and Shavuot are intimately connected. It's also clear that this was known by outside sources in Second Temple Judaism, like the Book of Jubilees, which begins to associate Shavuot with the giving of the Torah. So how are we meant to explain this? One possible approach is suggested by Rashi. On the Pasuk Yud Chet Aleph in Shemot, where it says that Bnei Israel came this very day, Etzem Hayom Hazeh, Rashi writes, Etzem Hayom Hazeh comes to teach us that the Torah should be new to you every single day. Perhaps extending this Rashi a little bit, we may say the following. If we would have known a specific date of Shavuot, then we would have put Torah learning and our connection to Torah in the box of something we do once a year. Just like matzah. Actually, I eat matzah all year round, apart from in the lead up to Pesach, but just like that. Meaning the Torah would have been something separate, would have been something for a particular day. But by leaving the date a bit blurry, we're able to connect Torah, and it urges us to connect Torah on a deeper, deeper, deeper level every day. However, I want to suggest and learn together another possible approach. The Netziv, when describing the mitzvah of Tefillin, writes as follows, that we have two Torot. We have a Torah Shebaal Peh and a Torah Shebichtav, which is parallel to the two kinds of Tefillin. We have a Tefillin Shelosh and a Tefillin Shel Yad. The Tefillin Shel Rosh represents the Torah Shebichtav, that which is worn on the head, that can be seen by everyone, and everyone who sees it knows our connection to Hashem. But, says the Netziv, we also have a Torah Shebaal Peh, a Torah which is hidden low down on our arm, that is only between us and HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Meaning, in order for us to have a very deep connection with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, we need to have a Torah which is hidden from the sight of the rest of the world. There's a Torah Shebichtav, the same one that's in the Sassoon Codex, that everyone sees and everyone wants and knows that that is the representation of our relationship with the Kadosh Baruch Hu. But the real Torah that really binds us together is the secret one that people don't see so readily. And that is really the heart of our strength and our relationship. To take this from another angle, we know that we read Maaseh Merkava on Shavuot as the Haftorah. The question is why? We know the Mishnah precludes one from delving into the secrets of the Merkava. Why does the Mishnah preclude someone from delving into those secrets? One, because they might come to mistake things and mistake the anthropomorphic associations of Hashem. But at the same time, there is an element, as pointed out by Rav Moshe Lichtenstein, that is related to tzniut, meaning we don't teach Maaseh Merkava out in the open because it is part of our deepest connection to Hashem. Hashem, whom with whom we got married under the chuppah at Har Sinai, is represented by our deep connection and the deep secrets held in Maaseh Merkava. So says Rav Moshe Lichtenstein, when we come to the festival of Shavuot, we dafka read Maaseh Merkava, and we're allowed to do so because that is the essence of the Chag. The essence of the Chag is our deep connection to Hashem, the Maaseh Merkava that usually we keep out of public view. But for us on Shavuot, we keep it there and we show it there because that is its essence. Paralleling that, I would suggest that the Torah Shebaal Peh is the essence of our relationship. It's even more hidden usually, and it is what we have with HaKadosh Baruch Hu. The famous metaphor of us getting married to HaKadosh Baruch Hu at Har Sinai, and that we are Hashem's beloved, is encapsulated in the Torah Shebaal Peh. Obviously, when a couple gets married, they stand under the chuppah as a declaration of publicly coming together. But that is not the essence of their marriage. The essence of their marriage is the link between the couple, the link which goes unspoken, which is such a powerful link because everyone around does not know. If you will, the Torah Shebichtav is a ketubah that's read out and held out at the chuppah. But the Torah Shebaal Peh are the whispers between HaKadosh Baruch Hu and Knesset Yisrael, and that is exactly what we are celebrating on Shavuot, the Torah Shebaal Peh, because that is the anchor which binds us together. I would suggest that's also the reason we count towards Shavuot, because it is us counting verbally. That's also the reason Shavuot is fuzzy in terms of how to portray it. It's also the reason it's not clearly connected to Matan Torah, because the essence of Shavuot is the Toshba, the Torah Shebaal Peh, our deep connection to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and that is what we're celebrating. In fact, on Shavuot, there is no real mitzvot associated with the holiday because it is not something which is to be defined, similar to what Rashi says. It is something to be relived on a daily basis, just like a couple relives their marriage and their connection on a daily basis. If we're to use Kabbalistic terminology, Shavuot cannot be about the Memalek Kol Olamim, that aspect of Hashem which is in the material world. That's why we don't connect Shavuot really to the agricultural festival. Shavuot is about the Hashem that is Mesovev Kol Olamim, the aspect of Hashem which is there and not there, which surrounds everything but does not enter everything. Because in that sense, the Mesovev Olamim is the deepest possible connection to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, because it's something which is intrinsic but is not really there. And so when Shavuot again is portrayed in a way not connected to Matan Torah, it is for that very reason, because at Har Sinai we experience exactly that. We experience the Torah and Hashem as Mesovev Kol Olamim, something which is surrounding us. Hashem and His Torah surrounds everything, shines light on everything, but He's not in everything in the same kind of a way. And if we're to continue this approach, it also serves to explain why we read Megillat Rut on Shavuot. Obviously, they're the reasons that most people know. But if we take Shavuot as the festival of Torah Shebaal Peh, the oral law, We learn in Megillat Rut something very important. In the written law, we learn that you cannot let a Moavi, a Moabite, enter the community. And yet in Rut, which describes the ancestry of Melech David and Melech HaMashiach, we learn, and on the basis of the Gemara, that the written Torah says Moavi, but the oral Torah says Moavi velo Moabit, meaning you can have a female Moabite enter the covenant and convert, but not a male Moabite, because essentially that teaches us that the ancestry of Melech HaMashiach is predicated not on the written law, but on the Torah Shebaal Peh. Once again, highlighting the fact that what we celebrate on Shavuot, its essence is our deep, deep connection to Hashem, which is not on display for everyone, but is the deeper connection that most people aren't even aware of. And by what reason did we merit to be so close to HaKadosh Baruch Hu? The famous Midrash that describes Hashem going from people to people and offering them the Torah perhaps points the way for us. Because in that Midrash, Hashem goes to one nation, offers the Torah. They read inside the Torah, see a law which doesn't work for them, and say, we can't accept the Torah in those terms. And yet it is HaKadosh Baruch Hu's people, B'nai Israel, who say without reading, without looking at the Torah Shebichtav, Naseh V'Nishma. Why do they say that? Because they're not interested really in the laws per se. They're interested in the relationship with HaKadosh Baruch Hu, which began from the Avot. They're not interested in reading what's written. Obviously that's important. But they're interested in the connection which comes about from two objects, HaKadosh Baruch Hu and Knesset Yisrael, which are destined to come together. So to end, I want to reflect on a few things. We, Baruch Hashem, live in a very graphic society, a society of words, of Facebook posts, of Twitter, of newspapers, of endless information. The other evening, I was sitting with my family at a coffee shop here in Gush Etzion, and they brought out a cake for a birthday girl at another table. The father had his camera out, watching as the cake was brought into the room, and the girl also had her camera out watching as it was brought down to her, because we live in a society where only if you record something, you experience it. Only if you tell people about it, it happened. Now that taps into a very, very deep fundamental element of human psyche, I believe, which is tied to our fear of death, our fear of disappearing, our need to kind of take pictures of everything, to remember everything, because without that, it's unclear to us that we actually existed. And I'm not a psychologist, I'm not going to get into that aspect of it. But fundamentally, we're always on the lookout to preserve something, to be able to grasp it and say, this is mine. Part of the message of Shavuot as the festival of Torah Shebaal Peh is to teach us that some things cannot be described. If you describe them, if you link Shavuot to the giving of Torah beferush, you miss the point. If a couple under the chuppah whispers to each other, but then afterwards posts that on Facebook, already that intimacy is lost, is taken down a notch. If you record it, it also ruins it, because the essence of that relationship is not something which is memale kol almin, but is mesovev kol almin. It is something that is so implicit in everything, in our relationship with Hashem, that you can't codify it. You can't write it down, because to do so would wreck the very thing you're trying to preserve. And that is why I believe all of these elements line up for Shavuot. The festival itself is not tied directly to Matan Torah, even though it's clear that it was in the time period of Matan Torah. The date of Matan Torah is not given in the Torah. The date of Matan Torah is fuzzy even for Chazal. We count towards Matan Torah verbally. No date is given for the festival like the others. And also we read Megillat Rut as a testament to the power of Torah Shebaal Peh to give us Melech HaMashiach, because fundamentally our relationship with Hashem is defined by the non-verbal communication, by something which can't be described, which is represented in the Torah Shebaal Peh. In that respect, I want to wish Rav Riskin Arichut Yamim and Or Torah Shiguru Michael El Chayil in spreading the light of Torah, meaning the deep, deep essence of Torah which can't be found in words, to all of Klal Yisrael. Chag Shavuot Sameach.